فعاش القلب إخلاصا وصرت تحومك الطير تحلق في ثقافات وتنهل من ربى الخير.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. In the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, most gracious, most merciful. Alhamdulillah, all praise is indeed due to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Wassalatu wassalamu ala rasulillah, blessings and salutations upon Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the messenger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the final of all prophets, the greatest of all creation, the most noble of all those who were sent by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Wa ala alihi wa ashabihi ajma'in. May the blessings be upon his family members, his companions, all of them. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless every one of you and every one of the ummah. And may Allah bless humanity at large. Ameen. My brothers and sisters, if I were to look at my own life and if I were to see how I developed and where I progressed, in a way that today I have got to where I am, I am never certain as to whether I will be going to Jannatul Firdaus. But I do know that by the mercy of Allah, we have been promised that we shall all enter Jannatul Firdaus if we follow La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. As I was young and I grew up, and I'm mentioning this for a reason, and perhaps you will pick it up as I am speaking, I grew up in a very strict home, very disciplined. It had to be a certain way. If it wasn't, we were beaten into submission in a lot of cases. It's a reality, and we enjoyed it because that's how we grew. Perhaps the generations now are very different. But I can tell you, as I grew up, I started studying the Arabic language at the age of 4 and 5, 6. I was already in an Arabic school. Together with my secular studies, grade 1 and 2. And within the next 3 years, 3.5 years, I'd started hifz. And we were strict. We were kept in a specific type of environment. Yes, we interacted with people of other faiths. We interacted with different types of Muslims. At that age, we did not know the difference, but there was a lot of understanding. We cooperated. We had friends from across the spectrum, everywhere. We knew our lines. When we took lunch to school, we knew that this is our food. We don't actually contaminate what we have that may be halal, because you don't know if the other might have pork or something that is not halal. So we were disciplined in that way. We were woken up for Salatul Fajr, and we had to fulfill that salah, sometimes by hook and sometimes by crook. May Allah forgive us. But it happened. And as we grew older, we became stricter in our following of Islam. I became a hafiz at a very young age. And I remember day in, day out, it was all about the Quran. You get up in the morning, you had to recite. You had to hand in your work. You go to school, as soon as you come back, it's all about hifz. We were excused from sports and sporting activity at that particular time. Initially, when I was in primary school. And I remember I still had friends. Some were white, some were black, some were Indian, some were Pakistanis, some were people we didn't even know where they came from, but we got along. We respected each other. And guess what? Something unique, we always knew who we were. But we respected everyone else. It's not like we swore them. It's not like we disrespected them. It's not like we didn't get along with them. We did. We were taught to respect everyone, but to know who we are. And not to compromise your faith just because you are watching someone else do something. But no need to insult them. From a very young age, we used to discuss. We used to debate. We used to talk about. We used to have these discussions where people would be convinced either way. And I recall, I always made sure that I learned about the deen and what Islam says and why I do what I do. People would ask, how come you guys don't eat this? And I had an answer just like that. How come you guys pray 5 times a day? And I had an answer like this. Why do you guys fast? And I had an answer like that. Why do you guys not do this and not do that? And I had an answer this way. But there was a lot of love amongst the humanity that we had there. We cared for each other. If I tripped, someone would have come to help me. The day we had an issue with others, there would be people who would come to assist. Subhanallah. And as we grew older, we learned more and more. And later on, high school, I went to a school that was perhaps one of the best schools in the country. It was a Christian college. That was the options that we had. The best option, perhaps. And what happened? My faith was intact by the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Inshallah, I was still the hafidh. I was still learning the books that I could learn. One after the other, I covered the courses that people would cover in 7 years, in 4 years. Why? Because every day, day in, day out, we would actually ensure that we learned, we studied, we did not waste time. But guess what? That made us better people. Stricter in Islam and more lenient with those who disagreed with us. But we had the power of revelation that came from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and at the same time, the gift that Allah has bestowed upon all of us, and that is the mind, the understanding, the knowledge. Knowledge is a weapon, it's a tool, subhanallah. But you have to make sure that when you disseminate that knowledge, it is only done respectfully. If you are to disrespect those you want to teach, you will never teach them, you will chase them away. So as we grew older, we interacted. We still had friends. Friends who were from other faiths as well. And wrong are those who say that a Muslim is not allowed to befriend someone who's not a Muslim. Those are wrong. They misquote and misinterpret the verses of the Quran of Surah Al-Ma'idah. When they don't know Tafsir Al-Quran bil Quran, the Quran has spoken about enemies being those who have driven you from your homes. They have fought you. They have assisted others to do the same. They have killed you, etc. You are not allowed to befriend those type of people. And that anyone would give you that advice. But when it comes to people of other faiths, we need to understand from a young age, all of us would know we got along with everyone. We did business with them. Our parents did business with them. They dealt with them. They were our neighbors. We fulfilled their rights. We exchanged gifts sometimes. We sent a little bit of food sometimes next door. And when they sent us gifts, we ensured that these were halal, so to speak. But we did not embarrass them, hurt them, insult them, etc. Why? Because as you grow up, you realize, you know what? You're not the only human being on earth. Allah created the earth. Allah created the diversity on earth. Allah made the Muslims, the non-Muslims, you and I, and even those who are not human beings. Allah made them. Have you ever thought of that? Allah created all of them. Why? Subhanallah. Why? If Allah wanted, He did not have to do that. He would have just made Muslimin and that's it. Who has the power of life? Giving the life, it's Allah alone. Taking away the life, it's Allah alone. If Allah wanted, He could have taken their lives away. We don't need to become cowards to start harming people just because we disagree with them. Subhanallah. Why am I saying this? My brothers, the most blessed vehicles that we have here, HGV, the Ford. HGV431EC. The EC part I know. It stands for Eastern Cape. So it's somebody here, inshallah. Can you move your vehicle, inshallah? It is actually blocking, and the brothers or sisters need to get out ASAP. If you get up here now, in front of everyone, we give you 10 du'as, inshallah. May Allah bless you. May Allah grant you ease. MashaAllah, MashaAllah. May Allah. I see more than one person getting up. Everyone wants the du'a. MashaAllah, MashaAllah. 3 people, 4 people got up. May Allah bless you all. Barakallahu feekum, MashaAllah. May Allah grant you barakah. May Allah grant us all barakah and goodness. We all make mistakes sometimes. And sometimes it's not a mistake, but it's just that it might be an inconvenience. So may Allah bless you all. SubhanAllah. The last time I did this, there were people who told me that next time we want our vehicles to actually gain value by you mentioning them in your talk and gain barakah for ourselves and our families. So we are definitely going to park our cars in the wrong way. So in order to combat that, I want to say those who have not had their number plates called out, may Allah bless you 100 times. Amen. MashaAllah, MashaAllah, MashaAllah. So my brothers and sisters, as we grew older, we learned that we are not the only human beings. There are so many others. Allah made them. So Allah made me for a purpose. I may have found Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. May Allah keep it that way and strengthen all of us. But My duty is to reach out to others in the best possible way. When the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam sent Mu'adh ibn Jabal, Abu Musa al-Ash'ari radiallahu anhuma, to Yemen, he told them something powerful. And I tell you, that statement only dawned as we grew older and we saw that the mahabba and the love that community had, society had, families had, has become slowly, slowly less. It's become less. People used to love each other such that, you know, they would do anything for you. Today, even if you're dying, they would probably say, Ya Allah, you've answered my dua. May Allah forgive us. May Allah forgive us. Look at how the love has become less. Where did we go wrong? We went wrong because we felt we were the only Muslims. That's it. I'm the only Muslim here. My view is the only view. My way of understanding things, the only way. I will fight anyone and everyone who holds an opinion different from mine, even if he substantiates it with قال الله وقال الرسول. I will fight him, attack him, and make sure that I embarrass him and disgrace him until Qiyamah. So we lost love. And this is called holiness, piety, and achievement in knowledge. No, it's not. It's actually the opposite. بَشِّرَا وَلَا تُنَفِّرَا وَيَسِّرَا وَلَا تُعَسِّرَا. These people were sent to Christians. They were sent to Christians. Abu Musa al-Ash'ari radiallahu anhu and Mu'adh ibn Jabal radiallahu anhu. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told them, you will go to Yemen, you will go to this area, you will go to this place. In another narration, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam tells Mu'adh ibn Jabal that you will go to the people of Ahlu Kitab, meaning the people of the book. Speak to them in a respectful way. Call them towards this, call them towards that, etc., etc. And in this narration, he tells both of them that, you know what? Give good news. Bashira means give good news to them. Speak to them, giving them good news. Today we are all seated here. Why? Why is this masjid filled with brothers and sisters? Because we want to get closer to Allah. We want to hear something that will inspire us, that will make us feel like we are loved by Allah. Allah loves you. He made you. He gave you the shahada on your tongues. Subhanallah, ensure that it is in your heart as well. You will enter Jannatul Firdaus. Have hope in the mercy of Allah, no matter what you've done. That's what we are here to listen to. Subhanallah, we have hope until the last point. I remember, not one person, but a few people who have said, we were in the nightclubs, we were doing drugs, we were doing whatever else, we were addicted to alcohol, we were committing adultery and doing whatever. Allah guided us. Alhamdulillah, we've quit this, we quit that, we quit that. Today we are trying our best to fulfill 5 salah to ensure that whatever we do is within the obedience of Allah. And I've known others who used to obey Allah, and from there they dropped so badly that they ended up in the clubs with the drugs, etc., etc. That is Allah. That is Allah's plan. You never know upon which condition you will die, so respect everyone else. And you never know upon which condition everyone else will die, so respect even those who are sinful, although you may dislike the sin. Remember this. The Prophet ﷺ says, Bashira, give good news. Wala tunaffira, and don't chase people away. From what? From the deen, from Allah. The way we speak, sometimes we chase people away from Allah. We chase them far away from Allah. Subhanallah, be careful how you speak. Be careful how you convey the message. وَيَسِّرَا وَلَا تُعَسِّرَا. When I read this, only now, beyond the age of 40, I started realizing, you know what? These are golden words. The reason the ummah has actually lost in terms of mahabba and love is because we don't follow what the Prophet ﷺ taught us. He taught us to spread love, to spread kindness, to spread ease, to give good news to people, to make them feel appreciated, to understand and to know how to correct a person, and to realize you are not the only human being on earth. You are not the only Muslim. You are not the only member of your family. When you're young and you're teenage and you think, that's it, it's my opinion, in my own family, you want everything to happen your way, there's depression in the home. You're not the only person. Come on, there's mom, there's dad. If they've passed away, may Allah give them Jannah. Ameen. And you know what? There's brothers, there's sisters, and there are others who will come in. Some of the brothers and sisters might be married and they might even have children. Their children grow up. It's not you. You're not the only one. There is a whole host of people. Allah put them around you to test you. What is your character going to be? Are you going to understand? It's not me all the time. It can't be me all the time. Me, me and I. No. You have to look at others. You have to appreciate others. كَانَ اللَّهُ فِي عَوْنِ الْعَبْدِ مَا كَانَ الْعَبْدُ فِي عَوْنِ أَخِيهِ. Allah continues to help his slave for as long as that slave continues to help another. You help someone, Allah will help you. Why? Because Allah has kept the path of reward through assisting others as well. That is why when you smile, it's an act of charity. I earned a reward because I interacted with you. I earned a reward because I served you for the sake of Allah. I earned a reward because I fed the poor. I earned a reward because I reached out to the orphans. I earned a reward because I went without any ulterior motive for the sake of Allah to help the widows and those who are in need, who were perhaps females or of the opposite gender. That was Allah. He kept a reward in us helping each other. There is a reward in respecting your family members. There is a great reward in mending relations. لا خير في كثير من نجواهم إلا من أمر بصدقة أو معروف أو إصلاح بين الناس. There is no goodness in any of their private meetings except for those who do what? Those who encourage charity. Charity meaning you're reaching out to other human beings. Sadaqah. When I give a sadaqah, who's benefiting? It is other human beings who will benefit, and I will benefit by the reward of having reached out to others for the sake of Allah. That is sadaqah. Amara bi sadaqah. Aw ma'ruf. Or someone who enjoins that which is good in a beautiful way, in the most respectful way, in a prophetic way, in a godly way. How did Allah teach you to correct others, to teach others? When the Prophet ﷺ taught people something, how did he teach them? With a smile, with respect, with so much of respect that even those who did that which was considered totally taboo, he corrected them in a way that within 5 minutes or even less, their whole tune changed. Take a look at one example. A man came into the masjid and he peed. He peed, he urinated in the masjid at the time of Rasulullah ﷺ. I don't want to get into the whole detail of the story, but within a few moments, the way the Prophet ﷺ dealt with it, he says, Allahumma arhamni warham Muhammadan wala tarham ma'ana ahadan. He says, oh Allah, have mercy on me, have mercy on the messenger ﷺ, and don't have mercy on anyone besides the two of us. Because of the way they dealt with me, that's why. And the Prophet ﷺ smiled and had to correct him again to say, you cannot make narrow something that is so broad, which is the mercy of Allah, Rabbul Izzati wal Jalal. So my brothers and sisters, this woke me up at a later stage in my life. When we are young, we are bubbling with energies. We think we are the only ones. I think I'm the best in this and the top in that and the most powerful. I can punch this guy and that uncle, I'll sort him out. And this one, I'll do this and that. And all the girls are looking at me and me alone. As you're young and you grow older, people pass through that phase. But you know what? When you mature, you realize at a later stage, you know what? I'm not the only guy. There are other guys more handsome than me. All the cherries are looking at them, not me. May Allah forgive us. Sorry to give you that example, but it's a reality. You realize, you know, I'm not the only guy. I'm not the most powerful. These guys will knock me out in two blows. You realize that. And then you come out, I'm not the most knowledgeable. And guess what? What I believe is absolutely correct. Yes, it will be according to me if I'm convinced with that. But others are convinced otherwise. My duty is to exercise that which Allah has given me, the intellect plus revelation. In fact, revelation before the intellect. And to beautifully teach them, praying for them. May Allah guide them. Or if I am wrong, may He guide me. The Sahaba radiallahu anhum, what happened to them? They had differences of opinion, very strong differences of opinion in some instances. They followed what they believed was right in one masjid. And they loved each other that they would give their lives to save the other. But they differed strongly in some matters. In fact, in quite a few matters, if you were to go and look into that. That is what we were taught. But when you're young, you haven't mixed with other communities, you haven't mixed with societies. So for you, it's a problem because this guy is reading Salah that way. And it's a problem because this guy, his belief strategy, perhaps he has this opinion that my brothers, my sisters, if they substantiate it from what is revealed, then you know that in the eyes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, there is scope for that. There are differences of opinion amongst the Sahaba radiallahu anhum regarding the understanding of the same verse of the Quran. They have two opinions, three opinions, four opinions. So it did not destroy the love between them. They loved each other so much that they believed in the hadith that you need to love your brother. A man could be dark-skinned, light-skinned, tall, short, poor, rich, etc. from your school of thought or another, etc. Wallahi, my brothers and sisters, be careful. The ummah is being destroyed because there are people chiseling through the few cracks that are there. We are here to build that again. To express the love that we are supposed to be having. Nothing will infiltrate us when we love each other. Yes, if you have a difference, you have every right to discuss it. You have every right to put it forth. Every right. It is called da'wah ila Allah. But Allah says,
"Ud'u ila sabili rabbika bil hikmah wal maw'izati al hasanah wajadilhum billati hiya ahsan."
When speaking to the people of the book, then you need to ensure. Listen carefully. When speaking to the people of the book, you need to ensure that you call towards Allah with absolute wisdom and with the best way of putting things forward. Al-maw'izat al-hasana. Al-hasan is a beautiful way of putting things forward. You give them a reminder in the most beautiful way. And when you put forth your opinion in opposition to theirs, you make sure that you do so in the most respectful manner. If that is the case, when it comes to us speaking to the people of the book, what do you think is the case when it comes to us speaking to each other as Muslims whom we may differ with? Today we have contemporary issues. We will differ on those. Some people might consider the stricter view on something, while others consider the view which is less strict. And sometimes people may change opinions from time to time. If it is based on what Allah and His Rasul have said, then you need to know you are not the only Muslim. You are not the only person who has the right to look into what is right and wrong. Nor am I. I'm not the only Muslim, even though there might have been a time when I might have felt that it is me and I, and what I say goes, and if anyone doesn't believe what I say, they are far, far from Allah and His Rasul. Astaghfirullah. May Allah forgive that type of thinking, and may Allah bless us all. Our duty is what? Take a look at the duty of the messengers. Allah says,
فَإِنَّمَا عَلَيْكَ الْبَلَاغُ وَعَلَيْنَا الْحِسَابِ.
Indeed, your duty is to convey the message, and our duty is to take account, to do the reckoning, to have the day of judgment to judge. Subhanallah, that's our duty, Allah says. Your duty is to convey. Did you convey? If you did convey, what was the method you used to convey? Was it prophetic? If the Prophet ﷺ did it, would he do it the way you did it? If the answer is no, you are wrong. No matter what, you need to improve. You need to become a more relaxed person. A sign of piety and closeness to Allah is that your heart is softened. That is a gift of Allah.
فَبِمَا رَحْمَةٍ مِّنَ اللَّهِ لِنْتَ لَهُمْ.
O Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, it is because of the mercy of Allah. It is by the mercy of Allah, a sign of the mercy, part of the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that you were very lenient towards those around you. So leniency is what? It's a sign of the mercy of Allah. Harshness is not a sign of the mercy of Allah. No matter what your view might be, it's not a sign of prophetic behavior, that which comes from the messenger or the teachings of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We need to improve ourselves. We need to reach out to the Muslims, the non-Muslims. How did we become Muslims, my brothers and sisters? Do you know? Your generations, have you ever studied it? Have you thought about it? Someone somewhere interacted with us, they cared for us. I know of people whose entire families are not Muslim, but they are Muslim. Are you going to tell them, cut off relations completely, become an orphan? And as it is today, when a person reads their shahada, and I've seen this many times, they'll come, they'll enter the fold of Islam. We ask them to repeat after us, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, wa ashhadu anna Muhammadan abduhu wa rasuluhu. They say that after us with its meaning. Then guess what happens? Can someone tell me? Part of the crowd, what do they say? Takbir! Don't they say that? They say that, isn't it? And what do we offer them? Let's hear it, let's try it.
takbir. There we are. It's like that's the only thing we have to offer. After that I'm gone, they're gone. No one takes care. You see them on the street, by the way. They want to get married. Now, this is a revert. He belongs to a different race, a different culture, a different this, a different that. No marriage, no nothing. So what was the point? What happened? Now, on top of that, you start issuing fatwas to say he must disassociate from his family, from his children, from his parents. He must come out of the house. He must do this. Now what? You leave him on the street. Is that what new Muslims are all about? Is that what a revert is all about? No, my brothers. No, my sisters. It is a disservice to Islam and the Muslims that we have perpetrated. It's something wrong. You cannot do that. Someone enters the fold of Islam, take care. Ask them to make dua for you. I have a friend by the name of Wa'il Ibrahim. And you know what? When he has helped someone enter the fold of Islam, he says, there's one more thing you need to do. So the person says, what? Now they've just entered Islam. And you know, in Islam, when you enter the fold of Islam, it deletes everything. So he says, you have to say after me, oh Allah. The person says, oh Allah. He says, please forgive, please forgive. Wa'il Ibrahim. Then Wa'il Ibrahim. So now what did he do? He made them repeat a dua for him because he says, you're so pure, you're so clean, you're so new. But anyway, that's on a lighter note. It's not part of entering Islam. But I'm telling you what some people actually do when they realize the value of these people. They've just entered the fold of Islam, purer than all of us. And what do? We excommunicate them and we teach them how to break relations when the Quran says, وَوَصَّيْنَا الْإِنسَانَ بِوَالِدَيْهِ. Allah has instructed you to be kind to both your parents. That same verse in Surah Luqman, Allah says, even if they were to strive or struggle to divert you away from Islam or to ask you to associate partners with Allah, that's the only time you don't obey their instruction. Otherwise, you live with them in goodness. Live with them in goodness. Who are they? Non-Muslims. Who are they? Your parents. The Quran is instructing you to live with them in goodness, in kindness, to fulfill their rights, to feed them, to clothe them if you have to, and what not, to fulfill all their rights. But they are not Muslim, subhanallah. They are not Muslim. And today when you talk like this, the pious from amongst us, those who read 5 salah, those who sometimes read 6 salah because they are regular with tahajjud, they say, no ways, these are not Muslims, astaghfirullah. No ways, you're not even allowed to look in that direction. Walk away. My brother, shaitan gets to you also, even if you read 6 salah a day. He can also, he does come to you on a daily basis. In fact, he comes to you in a more powerful way because you become arrogant. That's what it is. If you think you are pious and you've become arrogant, what you have is not piety, it is arrogance. لا يدخل الجنة من كان في قلبه مثقال حبة من خردل من كبر. He will not enter paradise in whose heart is even a mustard seed's weight worth of pride. Small droplet. You have to clean it first before you can go into Jannah. May Allah help us to love one another. That's why I am here today. I wanted to speak on this to say, brothers and sisters, if you do not feel love for the person sitting next to you right now, can I use a word? You are sick. You need spiritual attention. Because if you are part of the ummah, even with your differences, as we are seated here right now, you are meant to feel a connection with another who says that shahada. What is wrong with you? Where is your heart gone? Where is your identity? You love everyone who is here. You love the others. You feel for them. Subhanallah. You are connected in a powerful way. They also say, "Wa ashhadu anna Muhammadan abduhu wa rasuluhu." I bear witness that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is the final messenger of Allah. I'm trying hard. I may have followed, for example, a slightly different interpretation of a hadith, or for example, a verse of the Quran. That is not a reason for me to be disliking others, or for others to be disliking and detesting me. When it comes to La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah, wallahi, my brothers, the day we are going to separate ourselves is the very day that the enemies will overtake us. And that's what's happening today. Hatred. Hatred in one home. Hatred in one masjid. Hatred in one community. In one society. 20 different splits. Not just into two. 20 groups. Each one calling the other one names. To call someone a kafir. Do you know how dangerous that is? There might be deeds that lead a person to kufr, but to identify and say that man's a kafir, astaghfirullah, who gave you the authority to do that? By Allah, that man might end up in Jannatul Firdaus when you might have lost your iman towards the end of your life. It has happened, it can happen, it will happen. May Allah protect us from this. I care for you, my brothers. If you have helped someone enter Jannah, trust me, by the help of Allah, you will be there too. May Allah forgive us. I'm not the only person on earth. I'm not the only man who knows how to read the Quran. There are others as well. They may read better than me. They may correct me. I must take that correction. I must never think I'm a prophet of Allah. I'm not. I'm not a prophet of Allah. No matter how much I know, you have the right to correct me. And guess what? I need to sit and listen to what even the child has told me. Otherwise, I fall into the trap that Azar fell into. And my arrogance will make me deny that this is a reality. Yes. What trap did Azar fall into? Small boy, a son, telling him, Ya abati inni qad ja'ani minal ilmi ma lam ya'tika fattabi'ni ahdika siratan sawiya. Oh my father, knowledge has come to me that did not come to you. Follow me, I will guide you to the straight path. The young boy, instead of the father engaging him, he says, hey, I'll beat you up. Who do you think you are? You are wrong. Keep quiet. That's what we do today. Society, community, we think we're knowledgeable. We think we're a big deal. We think we're chiefs. We think we are at the top. And therefore, no one must correct us. No one must tell us anything. If they do, they are astray. We are the only ones who are guided. Let me tell you, Islam does not belong to you, my brothers or sisters. It belongs to Allah. You need to continue to strive to ensure that you're holding upon its ropes. If that is the case, you will achieve the mercy of Allah. And this is why, if you look at the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says,
قُلْ لَوْ أَنْتُمْ تَمْلِكُونَ خَزَائِنَ رَحْمَةِ رَبِّي إِذًا لَأَمْسَكْتُمْ خَشْيَةَ الْإِنْفَاقِ وَكَانَ الْإِنسَانُ قَتُورًا.
It's an amazing verse on another topic, the topic of wealth. Allah did not give the ownership of wealth to any one of us, and the rahmah of Allah and the mercy of Allah is not in the hands of any one of us, but is in the hands of Allah. Because if it was in any one of our hands, we would have held back. We wouldn't have wanted to give it to anyone. Look at the wealthy. May Allah make us all from among those who are truly wealthy with our iman and with our contentment. Because I tell you, true wealth has got nothing to do with the figure. It's got to do with the condition in the heart. You are content that you are wealthy. You are not content, you are not wealthy. Even if the figures become so many zeros that you feel like a Zimbabwean. My brothers and sisters, you know what I'm saying. You know what I'm saying. It's a reality, it's a condition of the heart. Imagine, sometimes when a person has wealth, they don't want to give, they become more and more miserly. I don't know if you may have noticed that. But there are others, as Allah gives them, they spend more. As Allah gives them, they spend more. There are so many examples. All this is for Allah to show you and I that people are different. Each one is earning his Jannah in his own way. Some people will enter Jannah through this, some people through that. But one thing for certain, those who have arrogance and pride, those who despise others, there is no room for them in Jannah. According to the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they have to cleanse themselves before they get there. So I'm here telling you, my brother, you are not the only person on earth. And myself, I'm not the only one on earth. I learned this as I grew up. Yes, we were quite strict. We learned Islam. And when we grew older, I tell you what helped me. Traveling and seeing Muslims across the globe. They may have differed from me in certain ways, but I found them sometimes way more powerful in certain issues, in certain things. Their love for the deen. And I was woken up to a reality that, you know what, you're not the only Muslim. There are people out there, all over the world, who are striving to obey the commands of Allah. When you travel to Europe, to America, to Far East Asia, to the rest of Africa, you wake up, you start feeling like, guess what, you know what, we're not the only Muslims. But when you're young and you haven't seen anyone, you're the only guy in your masjid for Salatul Asr, you for a moment think you're a prophet of Allah, astaghfirullah. May Allah forgive us. There are some who believe that, even without saying it, that you know what? I'm special, I'm big. Look, I come to the masjid. The others, they are not. They're going to Nari Jahannam. They're going to hellfire. That very thought shows that you are caught in the clutches of the devil. When you come for Salah and there is no one else in the masjid, you are supposed to weep and cry, make dua, and then go out in a beautiful way to market the product that you have. What is it? The deen. Imagine, and I'm sure a lot of us might have sold things in our lives, right? You have a product, you want to market it. What do you do? Say, for example, I'm going to talk to the youth here. You've got a phone, old phone. You want to sell it for the best price. So what do they use here? What's the website that they use? It's not eBay, it's something else. Bidobuy, I think, isn't it? .co.za. Sorry, I don't want to give it away, but it's there. And there's a few others. Gumtree. Someone said Gumtree. Yeah? So what they do, they take pictures of their phone. They make sure they are proper plush, posh pictures to ensure that this thing looks nice. You're selling a vehicle, your old VW. They used to call them the RSI, the Golf, you know, the VW, the fast one. And you take a picture of it. You make sure that it looks so nice. The scratches are not showing so much. And you look the other side, this side, and you put there 27,000 rands. O-N-C-O. Or nearest cash offer. Wow. And you put your phone number there and your name. And you make sure that it's so attractive and it's a beautiful. Why? You want people to phone you. 20 people phone you. You're so excited. Why? The guys are showing an interest in my car. I've actually pushed the price up to 28,000. Mashallah. You're happy. Wallahi, my brothers and sisters, how we think about marketing our cars and second-hand products and whatever else we have to sell in our shops and wherever else to market the deen is far, far more important. You have to think of the most attractive ways of marketing the deen and the cause of Allah. No matter what brings you to Allah, subhanahu wa ta'ala, it is important. It is important. I give you an example. One day, I was sitting and doing a live session on the internet. And a friend of mine comes in. When we were young, we were close friends. And he was told, you know what? Hang on a while because there is a live session going on. While later we happened to chat, he says, Sheikh, I want to tell you one thing. Please give up all this nonsense. It's against the Sunnah. It's against the Quran. It's something total. I said, Sheikhna, you know, you are my friend. We grew up together. Tell me something. How many Muslims are on the globe? According to me, approximately 2 billion. Right. How many have you reached out to? Okay. Someone reaches out to 100 in their way. Those are not the only Muslims on earth. We will be reaching out to someone totally different who doesn't even know who you are or your name is. So don't even fight. It's a totally different platform. It's something else. I remember a program that one of the ulama started in one community and he kept it a little bit modern looking. And everyone fought him. But guess what? The people who attended those programs were those who never ever attended any Islamic program before. So he was not stealing from their market. And this is where we go wrong. Because each one looks at it and says, yeah, this guy's taking from my territory. Brother, your territory is marked already. It's there, it's set, it's yours. We are not stealing from your territory. This is the world that belongs to Allah. We are using whatever platform Allah has given us in order to call people towards Allah and His Rasul. Be happy, make dua. No one's taking away from you. It's a totally different platform. We have not yet reached out to the 2 billion that's out there. Subhanallah. Look at your own community. I don't know how many Muslims there are, but I can tell you, if every one of us starts calling towards goodness, that is the only time we will be able to reach the entire community. But for as long as there is one from amongst us who's not calling towards goodness, you have not reached the whole community. You must remember that. So I can't think that I've got the school so no one else can do this, because there are others who are going to go there as well. I cannot think, no, this community is too small, we can't have this and that. You can do a lot. You need to make sure that you use and employ the best possible methods. Use technology to its extent, to its limit. I went as far as saying, if there is no video recording, I don't want to speak in the masjid. The reason is, if you record it by video, I tell you, within a week or within a month, you will have had 1 million people benefit from it. You might have a different view. I respect your view. I don't want you to change it. But don't want to shove your view down our throats. We also know what we are doing. We've also substantiated it by قال الله وقال الرسول. You follow? The point, the reason why I say this, you are not the only Muslim on earth. Your view is not the only view on earth. You are not the only person. What answer are you going to give Allah and His Rasul when others have reached people you couldn't dream of? May Allah forgive us. And you blocked them and stopped them and insulted them. And you called yourself prophetic. You called yourself a follower of the messenger. That is wrong. We are suffering because of people like you. The ummah is destroyed because of the hate that is spewed out of the mouths of those who call themselves religious. And we've had enough. So if you want to know if you are religious, and if I want to know if I am religious, I need to spread the message of love and peace and tolerance. And if I disagree strongly with you, I need to say it in a respectful manner. May Allah forgive me and forgive all of us. That is a prophetic method. Why is it that a small difference? I remember there was a brother who came in the masjid without a kufiya, without covering his head. And it was as though Qiyamah happened. Wallahi, people started saying, who's this kafir that walked in? Astaghfirullah, can you use that word? How dare you say that? If you want, all you needed to do is, if you really felt passionately about it, come up with something from in your pocket, keep a spare one, and it must be lovely, smelling good, looking good, such that he cannot resist it. He say, brother, mashallah, I brought you a gift. And you look at him with a smile, give him a big hug, and you put it on his head if you want, or he'll put it there. Some of us will come with a hanky. You know what's a hanky? We'll give him the hanky, snots and everything on it. He says, cover your head. May Allah forgive us. May Allah forgive us. What do we want? My brothers and sisters, this is a deen that belongs to Allah. Not everyone is on your level. Not everyone's on my level. And it's not like I'm on a high level anyway. We are all struggling. We all should be feeling that we have not yet got to the coast. The only time that you're allowed to be happy is the day of judgment, when you get your book in the right hand.
فَأَمَّا مَنْ أُوْتِيَ كِتَابَهُ بِيَمِينِهِ فَيَقُولُ هَا أُمُقْرَأُ كِتَابِيَهِ.
Allahu Akbar. That is the day we will be allowed to be happy. A person who's been given his book on the right hand. May Allah make us from among those. And you say, oh, read my book. That's the day. Up to then, I really don't know where I'm heading. I need to love everyone, and I need to use this opportunity on earth to reach out to people in a beautiful way, in a lovely way. And I need to know that there will never be a time on earth when every Muslim follows exactly the same opinion. Never. It's not going to happen. We have schools of thought, and these schools of thought are different. There's no hatred amongst them. No, not at all. There's love. They've already invented the wheel long back. You don't need to come and reinvent it again. They've forged an understanding between the schools of thought. Subhanallah. But we look at each other with skepticism. I remember long back, when I went into a community of Shafi'is, and some of the Hanafis in that community told me, you better repeat your salah. Wallahi, without a joke. And I said, but why? Because you know, you're not allowed to read behind these people here. And I'm like, hang on, you know, we were young, we were still growing up. Now I realized all that hate mongering was all un-Islamic. It was all un-Islamic. People tried to divide us, but we refused. And when we refused, some called us the villains. We will never allow that to happen. You could be a Hanafi, a Shafi, whatever. To be honest with you, you are my brother if you've uttered the Shahada, and you are trying your best to follow what was revealed by Allah through Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. You are my brother. And even if you follow a different religion altogether, I have to acknowledge that in humanity, we came from one mother and one father. I started looking at people on the street and telling myself, you know what, I may differ with this person, but I can't even begin to imagine that the reality is my great-great-great-grandfather and great-great-great-grandmother, myself and this person, was one person. I'm family. We are all related, every one of us seated here. You could be tall and short and dark and fair and whoever and whatever and from wherever and however. We are related. Sit and think about it. I am your brother, whether you like it or not. I am your brother, whether you like it or not. You are my brother, you are my sister. And guess what? I have to feel that if I don't, let me use the same word again, I'm sick. May Allah correct me. May Allah grant me shifa. And all of us. So this is why I'm so passionate about the message, because like I said at the beginning, let's learn to spread love. You disagree with someone, you have the right to disagree. Based on what you believe is correct, But they also have the right to disagree with you. You don't have the right to start spreading hatred and to start creating fitna and to create a problem and to destroy the whole ummah. Because if that's the case, we'll be small groups. Every single group will have 50 people, 200 people, 1,000 people, and that's it. Yet the ummah has 2 billion people. 2 billion. Why hatred? We disagree with some of what's happening across the globe. We see a lot of fighting and killing, sometimes in the name of Islam. And sometimes politically people are doing things and they want to use the Islamic image in order to sell their product. We believe all of that should stop, and we believe oppression should stop. And we may differ sometimes in some opinions, but guess what? That shouldn't make us create another little war elsewhere. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us love and understanding. Go back to the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Take a look at the Sahaba radiallahu anhum. Look at how they were with Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Look at how he was with them. Look at how he dealt with the disbelievers. Look at how just he was. Did he ever use cheap terms, vulgar words? Ever, ever? The hadith says the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was never vulgar. He did not use abusive words. Never. That's the prophetic way. That's the way of Allah and His Rasul. So when you want to guide people, by all means guide them. But use a prophetic way. Present your opinion, present its evidence, etc. And move on. Move on. Because today we are struggling. Each one, his aim and objective has become, how do I prove this particular person wrong in such a way that I drop him so that I can go up? My brother, by you dropping someone, that's no merit of yours. You haven't achieved anything. You have actually wasted your time. You present what is right and you move on. I don't need to talk about you and about that one and this one. And I don't need to mention people's names, etc., etc., because I would like to draw a straight line for people to benefit and continue. I want to inspire you to come for salah, to fulfill your salah, to turn to Allah, to engage in tawbah, to seek Allah's forgiveness because He is most forgiving, most merciful, to learn more about your deen, subhanallah. You might be following a different school of thought altogether, but guess what? You will still go to Jannatul Firdaus, because Jannah is not so narrow that just me and my cronies are going to go there. No! It's broad, we're all going to go there. You'll be shocked when you arrive there, how you'll see everybody there by the will of Allah. May Allah grant that to us. Amen. And I repeat again, brothers and sisters, take a moment right now. Check your heart. Those seated right next to you today, here. Do you have love for them? Do you feel for them? Do you actually feel a connection? The people who are right next to you, even if you don't know them, right here in this masjid, do you feel we can do better? We can do better. Look at the other and just think about how you love them for the sake of Allah. What are they trying to achieve? They are here, they are reading salah, they want to go to Jannah. Each one of us wants to go to Jannah. I was intrigued when the World Cup happened in South Africa, watching how people made a plan. You know what plan they made? They caught a lift with each other. They didn't know each other. Each one wanted to get to the stadium to watch a 90-minute match, right? Some went into overtime, by the way. But what happened? They made a plan. They decided, look, one car, we're going to have 4 people, at least, minimum, and let's all go. They made a plan early. Everyone was focused until they filled the stadium and they did whatever. That was for lahu and laib. That was for play and amusement. Can't we do that for the deen to say, I'm concerned about going to Jannah, you are concerned about going to Jannah, let's make a plan. When I go to the masjid, we're going to go together. I'm going to phone you if I don't find you at the masjid. Or when we go here, we'll do it together. We're going to sit in a halaqa, we're going to learn together. We're going to do this, we're going to do that. I'm going to help you, you're going to help me. And we care for each other. Wallahi, we have given more importance to football and to rugby and everything else than we have to Jannatul Firdaus. When it comes to our relationships with one another. We have. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala take us from strength to strength. May Allah help us to eliminate our weaknesses. So my brothers and sisters, remember this. If you want to go to Jannah, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam made mention of 2 qualities of the people of Jannah. Taqwallahi wa husnul khuluqi. Taqwallahi wa husnul khuluqi. Develop your consciousness of Allah and improve your character and conduct. That includes your speech. It includes the expressions on your face as well. It includes the way you interact with people, how you reach out to them. When someone says, this person has beautiful character and conduct, they carry themselves so well, they are so polite, that's called husnul khuluq, isn't it? So the hadith says, people will enter Jannah through their great character and conduct. Imagine. Do you have it? And I want to tell you something else. The two are connected. When you have the taqwa of Allah, it will automatically help you develop your akhlaq. If that taqwa is true. If it is true. But if there is something wrong with your taqwa, you begin to despise people. You begin to belittle them. You begin to make them seem cheap. You begin to use derogatory terms to refer to them. All that, you pay a price for it. Recently in my country, we have had an issue. What was it all about? I can tell you in one sentence. It was all about the misuse of the tongue. That's all. Because of someone misusing the tongue, there was a skittle effect of everything that happened thereafter. And the whole country changed within 2-3 weeks. Yes, misuse of the tongue. Go back, research, check what happened and you'll know what I said. Yes. What do I learn from that? Watch my tongue. I must be polite with everyone. Everyone. Speak nicely even with those you disagree with. What is it costing you? Nothing. What is it? You cannot be so lacking of intellect that you are impatient with what you have, that you have to swear someone to try and shove your opinion down their throat because you don't have the intellect to be able to engage in a beautiful, respectable discussion or to convey what you have in the most eloquent way that they are convinced. But because you know that what you have is not convincing at all, you have to swear, you have to become cheap, you have to create disunity amongst the ummah, thinking that that's what Allah and His Rasul wanted from you. That's not what He wanted. May Allah forgive us. Wallahi, my brothers and sisters, having traveled to a few countries across the globe, I have seen this in more than one country. And for your information, where the people have less materialistically, there is more mahabba, there is more love, there is more understanding. The people care for each other more. The minute materialistically we've become a little bit elevated, we tend to pull in our own direction. May Allah forgive us. May Allah grant us the love that we need. May Allah unite the ummah. I want to close by asking everyone, myself included, to promise Allah. To promise Allah that we will love each other for the sake of Allah. When we want to correct each other, we will correct each other indeed with love, with care, with beauty. And we will have the most beautiful way of speaking and communicating. May Allah forgive me. I am no angel. Trust me. I am no saint. I am no prophet of Allah. Astaghfirullah. I'm just a normal human being. I also become emotional. I also sometimes say things that I'm not supposed to. But that's what insan is all about. You say things, but immediately you recollect. You repent. May Allah forgive us. And that is not your quality, but rather it's a mistake you made. When it becomes your quality, you need to get worried. Why? Because now it's not a mistake, it's a habit. It's something that you need to spend time rectifying, working upon in the most intense way. Otherwise, that type of mischief will spread across the globe. And who knows, on the day of judgment, you may be resurrected among the troublemakers. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala not make us that. I've learned one thing. I look at people and I've seen people. I visited countries in West Africa. Wallahi, I need to share this with you. I visited a certain place. Salatul Fajr. We're entering the masjid. It was full. More than this, what we see now. And I told the brother, what's happening here? He said, no. Here, if you want to come into the masjid for Salatul Fajr, you need to be here 20 minutes before Adhan. Otherwise, the masjid is full. And I thought to myself, I'm not the only Muslim. Our community is zero. Zero. That's what I was thinking. I said, look at these people. I want to go home and tell the people that if you think you are close to Allah, wallahi, I've seen people who get to the masjid and they fill it for Salatul Fajr 20 minutes prior to Adhan. Allahu Akbar. Before you hear As-Salatu Khayrun Minan Nawm, the people are already in the masjid. They're there. I know of a wealthy man. He doesn't miss Adhan in the masjid. Wallahi. And when I saw these people, I told myself, you know what? I am nothing. I feel so far from the deen. Because you know what? There are people who proved me wrong. Then guess what? And these people are in Africa, in the most poorest parts of Africa. Subhanallah. Would you have imagined that? Imagine you were there. What happened to me? It was hair-raising. Subhanallah. It changed my life. It changed my life. I began to respect people, to say, Ya Allah, they are striving for you. May you forgive all our shortcomings, accept their good deeds, and accept the few that we are doing too. Subhanallah. Allah may overlook the weaknesses of some of us and grant us Jannatul Firdaus, while those who thought they had no weakness, who knows what Allah will do with them? I don't even want to say it. May Allah not do anything negative to us. May He forgive us. So this is why, learn to love, learn to respect. I've seen a man, very poor person, in one of the masajid in West Africa. And he was sitting in the corner. Everyone's going and greeting him. Everyone's going and greeting him. And you know what? I asked them, who is the sheikh? Let me go and greet him. They said, no, come, let's go greet him. I greeted him. He wasn't even speaking English. Greeted him and I continued. Later on, I asked the brothers who were with me, who was that sheikh? He looked like he had a lot of, you know, Noor. And Noor does not mean complexion, by the way. I've said it in the past and I'm saying it again. You can be as dark as ever and you can have Noor, and you can be as light as ever and you can still be filled with Balam and darkness. So they told me, this man is actually a poor person and he does peace jobs and he doesn't even have a home. Most of the time he's in the masjid, he sleeps around here and there, he comes. But something unique about him is when people ask him to make a dua for him, it happens. Subhanallah. It's called mustajabul da'wah. Perhaps it might not have been every single time. They were telling me every time. So he says people go to him and tell him, please make dua for us. He makes a dua. But he's found in the masjid all the time. He's in the masjid reading salah. He's the hafiz of the Quran. He finishes a Quran every 3 days. And he does whatever else only Allah knows. But I'm thinking to myself, this man's got nothing materialistically, zero. He doesn't have a home to live in. He doesn't have a family for some reason. And he's all on his own. He relies on handouts. And here people give him so much of honor and respect because they know something about him. How many of us would give honor and respect to a person who might be on the street and say, Sheikh, Sheikh, Salaam Alaikum, Sheikh, 2 rands, Sheikh. Have we seen that happening? We have. Allah says,
وَأَمَّا السَّائِلَ فَلَا تَنْهَرُ.
As for the person who is asking you, the one who is begging, the one who is asking, and we are not encouraging begging, but we are talking to those who witness others asking, don't rebuke them. If you don't want to give them, respectfully don't give them. If you're going to give them, respectfully give them. You don't throw it at them, you give them respectfully. And if you're not going to give them, still respectfully, what does a smile cost you? And don't say, inshallah, tomorrow I'll give you. When you know you're not going to cross that road tomorrow, you might want to say, next time, inshallah. Use the word next time, inshallah. But you don't have to say, you, what are you doing with that money? I think you're on drugs. I think you're doing this. You might have thought things. Be careful how you speak. Be careful. That could just be a friend of Allah who knows the circumstances. Allah created that man and Allah knew that on that day, at that time, at that second, at that moment, He was going to stand at your window and you were going to rebuke him and move on. So you achieved the curse and him, he lost nothing. He took away some of your good deeds. Allah knew. Allah put them there. They were placed there. Everything that happens to me and you is a test from Allah. So my brothers and sisters, guess what? There's good news and bad news. The bad news is the hour is up. But the good news is we have to go into overtime. If you recall, there were those 2 minutes that we spent calling out number plates. You agree? It's called injury time. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us ease. So we'll continue for another 2 minutes inshallah. So here I am asking Allah to help me to love everyone who has uttered the Shahada and to care for entire humanity in a way that I can reach out to them so that they see the beauty of the deen, because I'm an ambassador. I'm an ambassador of the deen and so are you. The minute your name is Muslim, you are a Muslim, you carry yourself you are supposed to understand you're an ambassador of Islam. Carry yourself in the same way that an ambassador would. People look at you and say, that guy with the kufiya, you know, he helped us. The sister who was in hijab, she assisted in such a way that we have to acknowledge, wow, these Muslims are amazing people. That's what the deen is all about. Reach out to people. There are people around us. We do business with them. Like I said, we work for them. They work for us. Sometimes they are brilliant. Sometimes they are better than some of us in their work, in their honesty, etc., etc. What do we need? You just need to speak to them with respect. Teach them, or at least reach out to them in a lovely way. You don't have to spew hate from your mouth against those just because they have chosen differently from you. We are blessed. We are living in a country where we have the freedom to practice our faith. But they too have the freedom to practice theirs. The same law of the land that we are living in has given us, that has given us this right, has given them the right. So you need to understand this. It doesn't mean that I suddenly became a Christian or a Jewish person or a Hindu or something else just because I acknowledge their right in a country like this to actually worship in a way they wish. It doesn't mean that. In fact, you're a strong Muslim. You have the freedom, fulfill your deen. How many of us with the freedom, we still don't adopt the commands of Allah. We have the freedom of coming to the masajid. Our masajid are empty in a lot of cases. Am I right or wrong? We become Jumu'ah Muslims. Jumu'ah Muslims. What else? We become Eid Muslims. Subhanallah. We become Eid Muslims. It's supposed to be Monday Mubarak, Tuesday Mubarak, Wednesday Mubarak, Thursday Mubarak, Jum'ah Mubarak, Saturday Mubarak, Sunday Mubarak. Do you know why? Every day is blessed. It's another day for me to earn a reward, to be able to enter Jannatul Firdaus. Who knows which amal Allah will love such that I will be earning Jannah through that. The problem is, it's only a Friday that we give importance to. Yes, the Friday is definitely greater than every other day of the week, but it's not the only day that you're going to read Salah. Don't get your facts mixed up. But at the same time, when you remind someone, do it in a beautiful way. They would love to listen to it. And they'll be motivated by it. My sisters, one point for you. And many points for the brothers too. In fact, let's not make it only for the sisters. My brothers too. The way we dress, do you know that we have the freedom to dress in a proper way? But still sometimes we don't. What are we waiting for? The day is snatched from us like it has been snatched away from others on the globe as well. And then we're going to say, oh shucks, you know what? I can't dress anymore like this because it's banned. But you have the freedom and you're still not doing that. And why I say brothers, because you know, before we used to concentrate on the sisters to say, sisters, dress appropriately, etc., etc. Until we started coming to the masajid and see some of the young people and even some of the older people embarrassing us such that you now got to lower your gaze in the saf in the masjid. Subhanallah. Because you don't know the brother in front of you what he is wearing. You know, they used to call them half bummers. I don't know what they call them now. May Allah forgive us. It's become an in thing, you know. I told one youngster, you know what, you need to lift up your jeans a little bit. It's a bit low. He says, but did you check my undies? I told him, what are you talking about? I thought perhaps he's trying to tell me something low. He says, hey, designer. And then I started laughing because I knew this guy is talking on a different vibe altogether. He told me, come on, it's the in thing. You've got to show your label, the label of the underpants. And I'm thinking to myself, gosh, I belong to the previous generation. May Allah help us and grant us goodness and ease. I still firmly believe when we come to the house of Allah, dress respectfully. Not only that, as a Muslim, dress respectfully. Didn't we speak about respect all along? Dress in a beautiful way. And you know what? You'll enjoy it. You will be on a level of respect where you respect others, they respect you. And inshallah, in that way, we will be able to grow. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us all. أقول قولي هذا وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على نبينا محمد سبحان الله بحمده سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك نشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت نستغفرك ونتوب إليك